I have run more tests. I have now finished three separate sets of tests. The first set was just the baseline test with everything stacked up as it was. I had the pot by itself, the pot covered, and the pot in a Cornish heater layout with the coins under the lid. And then I ran a second set of tests with the pot just by itself with the Cornish coin layout, and then the pot with the lid with it lowered. That one failed, which was understandable, but I was still a little surprised with it when it happened. And then I ran another set of tests where I did four different tests where I just put a bolt into the pot to see what kind of output I would get from that. And then I put another pot inside the first pot, and then I ran three pots. Oh, and the two pots, I also put a lot of metal into it to see if that made a difference. At this moment, I don't think it did, but I haven't been able to get all the information out. Haven't processed the videos. Then the three pots, I just loaded it up with all the metal, everything that I could, and got some interesting information. The first set of tests and the second set of tests basically produced the same heats, the same heat across all of them. Not too much of a surprise. With multiple pots, it dropped its overall output. Now, that's not a real surprise, but, you know, it did. Let's look at the total information. This is the data logging from the lowered tests, and as you can see, there are thousands of data points. And I ran these at 5 second intervals. All three tests are 5 second intervals. For the multipot, I forgot what I was doing and I set it for 10 second intervals for the first three tests. It's still six samples per minute, so it's not a huge deal. But on the last one with the three pots, I remembered and put it back to 5 second intervals. So if you want to see how many data points this is, well, let me just go down here. 7,500. Yeah, quite a lot. And I didn't go that far on all of them. Admittedly, these are going to be half as many simply because they were recording half as many to begin with. Then I have just the temperatures, and this is all of the data points gathered so that I can do a chart with them. Plus, I also ran the max, min, and average of each set of points. So these are just the data logging points, and I chopped off the three-pot one at about 4,000, 4,200 data points because it was, you know, room temperature, no longer needed to be followed. But as you can see, everything is very close to the same range. Now, before you say that there are two big arches up here, let me remind you that the one test that I did with nothing on the pot had the hole directly open to flow out, and the sensor is directly over that point. And so, of course, all of that heat is going to be focused on that one sensor, and it's going to be the highest. It's not proof that anything does or doesn't put out more heat. In fact, it's proof that when you leave a heat source open, it heats up one spot instead of all the others, and I'll show you more of that in a minute. And then I have all of the 5-minute data extracted from all of the tests. We have just the pot, we have the pot with the lid, we have the Cornish or with the coins, then the lowered with just the pot, the lowered with the Cornish, and the lowered covered, which didn't do very well. As you can see, there's not very many data points there. And I haven't extracted the data from the multi-pot tests, so I don't have that. But again, we have the two upper points there that are the hole, the sensor directly over the hole, so of course they ran higher, but everything runs at basically the same temperatures across the board. No real surprises, nothing to worry about. Also have the maximum and average, and again, the two sensors, the two runs with the sensor getting all of the heat, you know, that's what happens. But also, if you look across here, it really doesn't do much. The minimum is room temperature. The maximum is what it got to. No real surprises. And then this is all of the tests. Yes, I do. This is the first set of tests. This is the second set of tests. And I haven't gotten the third set of tests extracted yet. So, all of the tests simply prove that your temperatures are going to be about the same across the board. Now, I did run a program to pull out the upper right information from the data logging so that I could compare them at the same time frame. All of these data points are from the minute of 5 or the first reading of the minute from the data logging. Nothing really changes. You do get a little bit lower temperature total output when you have multiple pots to deal with, but I haven't been able to get that completely ready. So, moving forward, what can it do? What can this system do? Well, we have a heat source, 4 candles, and they're warming up some pots so that they radiate the heat instead of just allowing the heat to go straight up. And it does output some heat. It can warm a small space if it is well insulated. But there are those factors that have a big influence. Number one is the outside temperature. If it's above or below freezing, that's going to affect how much heat transfer there is in and out of the house, the space. The second is how well insulated and sealed your space is. The third is simply the size of the space. The size of the space is as important as anything else in deciding how much of a heat source you need. So let's talk about that. We have outside temperature. I had a person on my first video write in and say, you know, I tried this in a 5x8 bathroom, and with 4 candles, it didn't do anything, but my outside temperature was below 0 Fahrenheit, which is 10 or something below 0 in Celsius. Not sure what that exact number is, 5 or 10. So he had an incredibly low temperature to deal with, and the 4 candles just couldn't warm up that space. It just wasn't possible. So, you know, your ambient temperature is going to affect what you can do. Now, the other part, the next part of that is the size of the space. They were in a pretty small space. And then we have to worry about insulation. Now, for reference to this, there was a book written by an author named Laura Ingalls Wilder. It was called The Long Winter. And they moved out to a house, or whatever it was. I haven't read the whole story. Those of you who have, they were visiting a house. They were visiting a house that was in process of being finished. I haven't read the whole story, but it has made such an impact on the people in my life who have read it that they have talked about it a lot. But they hadn't finished closing the house completely. So boards had spaces in between them. There was a tar paper wrap around the house, and there was no insulation. And it was cold. They had a wood stove at one point. I'm not sure if this was in a blizzard or not, but again, if you've read the story, let me know in the comments. They had this wood stove running so hot that it was glowing red. And yet, because there was no insulation and there was gaps in the boards on the wall, whatever it was, they were all sitting as close as they could, maybe 5 feet away, and, you know, still not burn their clothes. And they were shivering and bundled up because there was just so much heat transfer out of the house. Insulation makes a difference. So those are the three factors. Your overall ambient temperature, the insulative properties of the building, as well as ceiling and air transfer and all, and the size of the space. I watched a video where a gentleman tried this with 4 candles under one pot, and I could see the walls over where he was sitting with his computer. There was no insulation. And after a while, he was like, you know, this really hasn't done anything. And I'm sitting there going, duh. All of your heat's going out of the non-insulated walls. So, yes, this will heat a space, but it has to be small enough, it has to be well insulated, and it can't be larger than the amount of heat that 4 candles can put out. So how much power can 4 candles put out? I ran across an article on a website called heatertips.com. It was written by Daniel Hirsch, who is an electrical engineer with a vivid interest in home heating methods and devices. And being an electrical engineer, he's probably designed more than one. So he has 5 things in this article that are the negatives of the candle heater. Let's start out with the important version, the important information here. How many watts does a candle have? A gram of paraffin wax can burn at approximately 8 grams every hour. That's with a quarter inch wick, which is pretty much the way that they're designed to burn. And so you're looking at 0.00216 milligram or grams, which is 2.16 milligrams of burned wax per second. So doing some chemistry, math, and so forth, 8 grams of wax has about 37 kilojoules of energy, and a single second of burn time is going to give about 80 watts. And that's, you know, running the full height flame and everything. But the reality is, it's only going to put out about 45 to 80 watts continuous, because every candle burns a little bit differently. And I saw this in my testing, that some of the flames were a little higher than the others. You know, that's why I need to run this multiple times, which is something I'd like to do. So, candles can put out about 80, give or take, watts, give or take, continuous. Every second. So what does that mean? Well, if you have a space heater, you'll have three settings. Low will typically be about 500 watts, medium will be typically be about 1,000 watts, and high will typically have both elements burning, running, and with a fan and the two elements, it can run about 1,500 watts, minus efficiencies and other things. So, you know, 1500 watts. That's the rating. That is the maximum that you can pull out of a standard wall plug and not cause a fire and not trip your breaker. So, always good to not cause fires. Now, how big of a space would you have or want to have this in and run it on low and be comfortable in? Again, those three factors are going to come into play. How big is the room? How well insulated is the room? And what's the outside temperature from, you know, both inside the house and outside the house? And is it going to be able to heat up that space? If you're in a, you know, a fairly large space and you run this on high, yeah, it could warm up the space eventually, but it's not going to do a lot. So if you have four candles and they're each putting out 80 watts or less continuous, you're not going to heat much of a space. So it can heat a space, but it can't do a lot unless you have multiple candles. Now, in this article, he says that if you're running about 80 watts per candle, you'll need about 20 candles to heat a fairly good sized living space. And then he talks about safety and replacing the candles and watching the candles and make sure that they're all there. And he kind of throws up his hands and says, guys, this is totally unrealistic. It just doesn't make sense to do this. And I rather agree with them after having had some failures where, you know, a wick just bent over because it was bending too far and it buried itself in the wax. What do you do? You have to pull it out, make sure the wick is standing up straight and light it back up and then hope that it doesn't have any other problems. So you have to be aware of what the candles are doing, you know, not bending over into the wax. I had that happen one time with a candle where it just leaned over and went under the surface of the wax, and I had to pull it out, and I actually had it happen twice. One time I got it out of the tray and got it stood back up and relighted, and everything was fine. The other time I knocked it a little bit, spilled a little bit of the wax, and it, you know, that can happen. So, you know, unless it's really an emergency situation where you have no other choice, it really just doesn't make sense to run these candle heaters. His suggestion is a propane heater, and I got to say those are really good because they will burn for a very long time if you have a propane tank that's large enough. A 20-pound propane tank will run a low output, about 9,000 BTU heater for most of 24 hours, 5 or 10,000, whatever it is. I know I've done it. So what can't it do? Well, it can't heat a huge space. Four candles, 80 watts continuous, it's not really gonna do much of anything. But then there's the other question mark, and that is, does adding more pots make any difference or help anything at all? There is the myth, statement, whatever out there, that if you have it under three pots, you're going to catalyze the exhaust and it's going to put out more heat and so forth and so on. Unfortunately, that's just not really true. Now, I have run a test with three pots, and it did get teeny tiny little bit higher heat than the test with the other two pots, but it didn't put out as much heat as the Cornish heater. You know, I haven't been able to digest those videos and pull out the 5-minute increments. I do have the data logger. These things are awesome. After it ran, I downloaded the data and I have looked at that, and I saw that since it was in the center of the pot, it got a lot of heat. But then I started going, well, I've got a larger pot than the other test, so it's a little closer. I don't want to say that that proves that it could be a little bit warmer, but you know, it just doesn't really make a difference. I will see what I can do about running this again, but I've also got to pull out all the other information from all the videos, since I don't have a lot of these to work with, and I can't just dump the information. Oh well. But this is good information to start with, and I can at least share one small part of this. Testing moving forward from here. I have the data logger, which is immensely helpful in getting consistent and frequent measurements, but I would like to test with metal pots. That would be interesting to see what a difference the metal makes. You know, I've seen a layout with a paint can, I've seen a layout with a soup can. I'd like to try it with at least a metal pot. I may have to take the handles off so that the plastic doesn't burn, but it would be interesting to see what I can do with metal and if it really makes a difference on the output. I'm not expecting that it can, but you know, maybe. I would like to try that. I would like to rerun all of the main successful tests that I have done with the open pot, with the lid, with the coins or the Cornish layout, with the two pots, and with the three pots. And I'd like to do them at least three times. I would love to be able to do 10 times, but that will take me all year. Literally, I just don't have that much time. And I would like to run a test with the three pots, and probably with the two pots, for a minimum of 8 to 10 hours, just to see if keeping it at temperature will do what people say and create more heat, or if it will just be consistent and static in its heat output. That is what I hope to do moving forward. The problem is, my employer may have me working Saturdays, which will drastically limit my ability to do more than one test a week if I'm going to spend, you know, 6 hours per test having to monitor it, make sure the candles don't bury themselves, make sure that the system works correctly and it doesn't cause any other problems. So I hope to continue doing that, but it just takes time. And extracting the information from the time-lapse videos, even at 5-minute increments, is a very long and rather painful process. I will do what I can. But that's for moving forward.